Welcome to Take the Lead Radio with Dr. Diane Hamilton, where she interviews some of the most successful leaders, entrepreneurs, authors, speakers, and other individuals who will inspire you to take the lead in your career and personal life. And now, here is Dr. Diane Hamilton.
Welcome to Take the Lead Radio. This is Dr. Diane Hamilton, and today's show's very interesting because we have Steve Forbes here, and Steve is such a nice guy to be on the show. He and I have worked together at the Forbes School of Business and Technology. I was the MBA program chair, and I continue to work with them at their board of advisors and their speaker programs and different things, and so I get to see Steve a few times a year sometimes, and he is such an interesting guy, and I was really grateful to him to share, because he's going to share his information about a lot of different things: leadership, success, his book, and politics, running for presidency, you name it. We're going to talk about it today. So stay tuned, and we'll be back right after this.
Attend any corporate summit, and it's likely someone will bring up issues with millennials or other generational conflict. In the book, It's Not You, It's Your Personality, the authors explore the post-boomer generations and how to use personality assessments to get along in the modern workplace. Learn what makes the younger workforce unique. Filled with tips, tricks, and techniques, It's Not You, It's Your Personality outlines various scenarios with different personalities to give you a more detailed look at how different people can more effectively work together, both in team situations and when various activities require them to better understand one another. You'll learn how to recognize character traits in others, as well as in yourself, and what to do about the traits that need help. Entertaining as well as educational, It's Not You, It's Your Personality makes understanding personality assessment essential to workplace success. To get your copy, text the word Diane, D-I-A-N-E, to 38470. That's Diane, D-I-A-N-E, at 38470.
Robots, self-driving transportation, and a dynamically connected cross-cultural virtual world will define the workplace of tomorrow. However, education today is mainly focused on technical learning and standardized testing. Is this preparing kids for future leadership? Unfortunately, not so much. That's why LeaderKid Academy offers programs based on the persona model and focuses on developing emotional intelligence, project management, change management, mindfulness, assertiveness, ethical leadership, resilience, creativity and innovation, and presentation skills. LeaderKid Academy offers educator mentoring and training workshops, after-school programs, and ongoing sessions. Unleash the leader in your kid. To learn more, visit leaderkid.org. That's LeaderKid.org. I am here with Steve Forbes, who needs no introduction, but I'll give one anyway. He's the chairman and editor-in-chief of Forbes Media. Steve has authored many best-selling books. His latest book is titled Reviving America: How Repealing Obamacare, Replacing the Tax Code, and Reforming the Fed Will Restore Hope and Prosperity. Steve writes editorials for each issue of Forbes under the heading of Fact and Comment. A widely respected economic prognosticator, he is the only writer to have won the highly prestigious Crystal Owl Award 4 times. In both 1996 and 2000, Steve campaigned vigorously for the Republican nomination for the presidency. And key to his platform were a flat tax, medical savings account, a new social security system for working Americans, parental choice for schools for their children, term limits, and a strong national defense. So it's so nice to have you here, Steve. Thank you for being on my show.
Good to be with you, Diane. Thank you.
Oh, you're welcome. And, you know, this show is about success and leadership, and I can't think of many brands that have had the success you've had with Forbes. And I know a lot of people want to hear about your political views, and I'm going to get into that, but I just wanted to focus first on your success. I mean, your family has been very successful, your father, your daughter. I'm curious, were you raised, do you think that you were born to be a leader, or were you groomed to be one? And I'm just curious if your dad would have been disappointed had you not wanted to be such a big part of Forbes Media.
Well, I think leadership comes from you know, some people are naturally outgoing and things like that, but real leadership comes from experience, and it comes from setbacks as well. For example, you take Steve Jobs. He had to learn very painfully how to be a leader. He was a kind of guy who human resource departments would have run away from
right.
if they didn't know the name.
Mm-hmm.
He took credit for other people's ideas, always yelling, rejecting ideas, and then taking them a week later as his own. Couldn't work with people, wrote people the wrong way, fired them left and right. So he's fired from his own company before he's the age of 30.
Right.
And but from that experience, painfully, he learned how to be a leader, one of the greatest leaders ever. So you're not born to it, you learn from it. And the attributes are very, very simple, easy to say, hard to do, having a vision, establishing trust, knowing how to delegate authority. Sometimes pairs work better than a single person. Talking about Jobs, originally with Steve Wozniak, Brin and Page for Google, Henry Ford and James Cousins at Ford. So you may do it as a pair. But one of the things about leadership is that no matter how good you are, no matter how smart you are, one, you're going to have crises. They can come from your own mistakes, from outside forces, whatever. But you're going to face crises, and sometimes you're not going to have a playbook. You're going to be lonely. You're going to have to do it on your own. You may have teams working with you, but you're on your own because you are the number one. Another thing about leadership in that respect is that in addition to a crisis, you have to be an innovator if you want to be an effective one. Just give you an example of a very small way, but put it under the heading more of entrepreneurship and leadership. My grandfather was an immigrant to this country, one of 10 children, grade school education. And when he came here over 110 years ago, he wanted to get a job as a business reporter, and no one would hire him. So finally he went to an editor one day and said, I'll work for you for free. And if I show you my worth, I trust you'll hire me. Now, my grandfather had no idea whether the editor would just take the free labor and then throw him out.
Mm-hmm.
But my grandfather realized if you do things the normal way, you're going to go nowhere. So fortunately, he got the job. But then, as an addendum, he was so full of energy and ambition that he used another name, got a job with another publication, and probably is one of his happiest moments is when the two editors got into an argument as to who had the best business writer. It was my grandfather in both cases.
That's great. I had not heard that. I love that story. Well, you have some great stories. I've been fortunate to be around you in a lot of settings, and I'm very fascinated by everything you've done. You talked about crisis and innovation and how leaders have to face that. What do you think was the hardest thing you've had to face? Was it when technology changed, becoming more digital? What do you think has been hardest for you?
Well, there have been challenges succeeding my father to more than 25 years ago when he was this very well-known public figure, and people wondered what was going to happen now. They're very skeptical. But you hit it on the change in technology. The rise of the web just threw out almost everything we had learned about print media. You know, print media hadn't much changed since the 1840s in terms of basics, and with the invention of the steam press, which made possible mass publications, magazines, and newspapers. And suddenly along comes the web. And so you take Craigslist, eviscerated newspaper classified ads, mm-hmm. which started their downward decline, rapid downward decline. Then you magazines. We were hit hard with the web. So we had to remember what Peter Drucker said, the late great management guru. He said that businesses should always remind themselves, what is your purpose? What is your mission? And if you keep reminding yourself of that, then you don't get quite as hung up if the tools to achieve that mission change, or that the scope of the mission may be enlarged by these new tools. So we did. We developed Forbes.com as a separate entity, did not make it part of a print, because we knew that print would, human nature being what it is, use it for its own immediate purposes, and we wanted this baby to grow vigorously on its own. Then we combine the two 10 years later, very, very difficult, very, very real culture clash, very messy, but we had to do it. So today we now face challenges with mobile devices, the advertising juggernaut of Google and Facebook. So as they say, we live in an era where you can eat well or sleep well, but not both.
Well, you seem to be doing things correctly. And I mean, you must be doing something right. I love how you have these summits. I've attended quite a few of your Forbes summits. I was just at one with you where you interviewed Kim Kardashian. And I think it's interesting to see. I've seen you interview so many people, and you really get a background on the people. You do research in depth and you've watched her show, as you told me, and you got into it.
Yes.
So I'm sure that must have been interesting for you. I'm just curious, with all the people you've interviewed, other than politicians, who did you find the most interesting in the business world? Is there any couple names that really stood out to you? And I'm just curious what you liked about them.
Well, let me hit one on the public side, which was Margaret Thatcher. When you interview most politicos, especially in government, they have their own script. Right. They know what they want to say to you. Mm-hmm. And you can ask all the questions you want, but they're going to try to do what they want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's often a sterile exercise.
Right.
However, with Margaret Thatcher, she didn't hesitate to mix it up. And if you said something she didn't agree with, she didn't hesitate to get in an argument with you.
That's interesting.
It was natural. It was vigorous. So she was highly unusual in that respect. And another one, we all know about Ronald Reagan, but another one who died recently, the former Chancellor of Germany, Helmut Kohl, who no one remembers today, but he was critical for winning the Cold War in the early 1980s, along with Reagan, Thatcher, and Pope John Paul II. And when he came into power, the German press portrayed him as this country bumpkin, bumbler, kind of stupid oaf.
Yeah.
And so we interviewed him, and we were dazzled.
Wow.
This guy was anything but an oaf. He was brilliant. And we made clear, we ran the interview in Forbes, and we made clear that don't believe the media, I guess today we'd call it fake news,
right,
about their portrayal of Helmut Kohl.
That's
and then in the business world, you get all sorts of interesting people, especially in the investment world. People like Jack Bogle, who invented indexing, Burt Malkiel, who came up with the efficient investment theory. We did a cover story on him over 45 years ago. And then there was another one, not quite a businessman, but a fellow named David Kammerman, who got a Nobel Prize for psychology, economic psychology. And he learned psychology the hard way. He was a great advisor in the investment world. Everyone turns to him, especially money managers, for insights on how markets react, how people react. But his story was amazing. He's Jewish, grew up in France, and when he was 6 years old, the Germans occupied Paris, and so he and his parents had to wear the Star of David. And the Jewish residents of Paris had a 6 p.m. curfew. If you were seen outdoors after 6 p.m., you were done. And so he was playing with a friend, this 6-year-old. Time passed, and suddenly he realized it was after 6. And he knew he better try to get home because his parents would look for him. They might be arrested. He'd never see him again.
Wow.
So what do? So he took a sweater with the Star of David and turned it inside out, and put it on and hoped no one would notice and he could walk home and nothing would happen. As he was walking home, the nightmare happened. He spotted the black uniform. That was the uniform of the German SS who did the Holocaust. And he thought, uh-oh, this is it. The guy came over to him, looked at him, lifted him up, and then hugged him and said to the kid, "You remind me of my son at home. I'm so glad to see you." He showed him a picture of his son, And meanwhile, this guy was, the kid was hoping that he wouldn't feel this German officer, the Star of David, inside his sweater. And so here was a guy who, if he'd seen the Star of David, was quite happy to kill him. But because he reminded him of his son, he was hugging him, and Kevin recognized, he got home all right, recognized this is a very strange world we live in.
Wow. You must have so many stories that you've heard that just must be, I mean, your day has got to be very fascinating from just all the people you talk to and all your experiences. I mean, I remember the first time we met, I remember asking you just what it was like to run for president. I mean, you've done that twice now, right? And so I'm curious, not only just what your day is like, but what would make you want to do something like that? That's a tough job to have. What made you want that job?
well, things often don't go according to script in life.
Uh-huh.
And back in the early 1990s, I had no intention of running for public office. And at the time, I was heading up an organization called Empower America, which was a reform organization founded by Jack Kemp, Gene Kirkpatrick, Bill Bennett, to be sort of a think tank, come up with policies, pro-growth, Reaganist kind of economic policies and foreign policies. And we all saw it as a vehicle, really, to frankly prepare for Jack Kemp's run for president in 1996. He'd run in '88. He was very well known for his tax-cutting work. His tax plan was the basis for Reagan's tax cuts in the early 1980s. So we all assumed we were going to run in '96, and we were going to provide the research backbone for it and advocate the kind of policies he would advocate. And so then in December of 94, he called us into his office, and we thought he was then going to tell us, we're going to disband the organization, we're going to go out and start this thing. And he shocked us. He said he wasn't going to run. And we were blown away.
Huh.
And so I looked around for a pro-growth, Reagan-Kemp-like candidate, optimistic, didn't find any. And so I thought, well, instead of complaining about it, do it yourself. And I guess I was taking a page from my grandfather, who was a business writer, as I mentioned, and he wrote about movers and shakers, and he finally decided he wanted to be one himself, which is why he founded Forbes Media. Just didn't want to write about entrepreneurs. He wanted to become one himself. So instead of just writing about political issues, I decided to get in it myself.
Well, you definitely are an expert. And I mean, I am always amazed by the insights you have on politics, and I'm just curious how you feel about the political climate, how it's changed in your lifetime, and is there any, what do you like and dislike about what you've seen in those changes?
Well, what is amazing is the intensity, especially on the left, the intensity mm-hmm. of that people hold their views, almost as if it's personal, it's religion, mm-hmm. and how you cannot countenance any kind of differing opinion. And so if you're at a party and you want to wreck it, just start talking politics, and
yeah,
kaboom.
All right.
You know, once upon a time, back in the old days, they told people at a dinner party, you don't discuss religion, you don't discuss politics, and you don't discuss sex. Well, no one's interested in religion, many people anymore, and they don't discuss it publicly. And politics, perhaps we should bring that taboo back. Don't do it when you're amongst company, when you're among people.
Well, I bet a lot of people want to talk to you about it, though, and so I'm sure you get drawn into a lot of conversations. You know, I saw an article you wrote about Arizona. I live in Arizona. And I was thinking about, you were making some predictions about how they were growing here and in terms of industry. And It reminded me of the Forbes Summit I attended in when you interviewed like Steve Case, the creator of AOL, and all that. And back then they were talking, it was a Midwest conference, and they were saying that the Midwest was kind of the former Silicon Valley because innovation used to be there before, now it was in California more. Where do you see Arizona? Do you see other areas like, do you see the next Silicon Valley somewhere else? I'm just curious where you...
The valley still has the mystique, just as in the early 1800s when the Industrial Revolution was getting underway, the city of Manchester, England, became the symbol of industrialization, and so too Silicon Valley, the same thing today. But there are many other centers. You find them in Austin, Texas. You find them in Provo, Utah, and all around the country. And that's the nice thing about high tech; it can disseminate. Even though the valley is still very, very important and is strong enough to survive the crazy government policies in California. I don't know how long that'll last, but so far they've been vigorous enough. And one of the things, and my friend John Tamney, who writes for Forbes, has pointed out, and others have pointed out, is that in Silicon Valley, you have more business failures there than in any other part of the country. Now, we think of failure as stagnation. There, it's a sign of vigorous life. People constantly trying new things, and the ones that succeed do mightily well, but most don't. And so that kind of vigor, when people say, oh, we must save businesses, and in Silicon Valley, they shoot them every day. And yet it's one of the most dynamic wealth creators, technology creators in the world. So, useful lesson. You need constant experimentation to make progress. But high tech is all over the place, and I tell you, one of the high tech centers of the world, soon to rival in some ways Silicon Valley, is the state of Israel. All of 8 million people. In terms of listings on NASDAQ, there are more, other than the U.S., there are more listings of Israeli companies than any other country in the world, technology startups. They are a high-tech powerhouse, 8 million people. They do more than the continent of Europe with 500 million people.
Wow, that's interesting. You know, there's so many factors to take into account when you do predictions, and I know you know, you're talking about that country and other places becoming the next big thing. And you won that, I mentioned, that prestigious Crystal Owl Award 4 times. Now, I'm curious, what kinds of things have you had to predict to win that honor? Is it things like this where you're seeing the next up-and-coming area? What do you have to do to win that?
Well, when they had the prize, it was an annual one, and they'd get journalists together each year, the U.S. Steel Corporation. And they've since retired it years ago. But they would get together and you would predict what was going to happen in the coming year, what the stock market would be, unemployment, GDP, steel production, and a number of other items. And those who got it right, whoever got the most right, won the prize.
Well, you get it right a lot. Well, that's good to know. So it's interesting because I want to talk to you about your book a little bit, because I had interviewed John Tamney, and we, you know, have worked with in the same settings with him, and he was very interesting about his thoughts on the Fed. And I know your latest book is about replacing tax code and reforming the Fed. And you stated that there were 3 big reforms we needed to address. Can you just explain what those are and how to fix them? Would help.
Yes. Healthcare. We do need a system that is more oriented to the patient. And I hope before the end of the year, the Republicans, who are trying to live up to their moniker as the stupid party, flounder on healthcare. I think eventually they'll do something, but they should recognize, just as the old cliche, Rome wasn't built in a day. You're not going to reform healthcare system in a day, but there are a lot of useful steps you can take to put more power in the hands of the patient. The problem with healthcare, Diane, is that it's all third party.
Right.
Insurers, government, Medicare, Medicaid, VA, it's big companies, and there's a disconnect between the patient and the doctor. And so hospitals know their revenues come not from pleasing you, the patient, but from how well they negotiate with third parties. Insurers want to get big so they can better negotiate with hospital chains. So the patient is on the bottom of this food chain, so to speak.
Right.
And the proof of it is the lousiest motel in America wouldn't dare put you in a room with another guest with a curtain in between. A sick guest, as they routinely do in a hospital.
Right.
So we recommend in the book a variety of ideas to start getting the patient back in charge. One is nationwide shopping for health insurance, so you get hundreds of companies competing for your business. Right now, if you live in Arizona, you can't buy a policy offered, say, in Colorado, mm-hmm. which is ridiculous. You can buy an automobile in New Mexico, but you can't buy the insurance.
Right.
It's crazy. Have invoke the Interstate Commerce Clause. Have a nationwide competition. Another thing, equal tax treatment. Unless you're self-employed or an employer, you pay for insurance with after-tax dollars. So if you don't like what's being offered by your employer or you're not offered a plan, you go out in the individual market, good luck. You're using after-tax dollars. That's crazy. Another one, transparency. Why shouldn't clinics and hospitals post prices for all their services? And you'll see some very strange things emerge. For example, a friend of mine in New Hampshire a couple of years ago, had some heart thing, and so he went to the cardiologist. And one of the things the cardiologist recommended to him was you should take what they call a nuclear stress test, where they pump something in your body and they watch it flow through the bloodstream or whatever.
Uh-huh.
But anyway, he then innocently asked the doc, what does it cost? Doc said, I have no idea. Insurance will cover it. So you don't get
word.
The pricing system. Uh-huh. So this guy, being an entrepreneur, went out, a great effort, his colleagues got the prices of a nuclear stress test, which is routine. I mean, everyone does it the same way,
mm-hmm.
so there's no difference in quality. And went to some 25 clinics and hospitals and got prices, finally pried them out, and they ranged from $1,450 to $7,300.
Wow.
For same test. So
wow.
Have posting of prices. So you can compare, especially now as we're getting more and more high deductible plans.
Mm-hmm.
We need to see those prices. Another thing, how about hospitals posting how many patients die of infections after they're admitted to the hospital?
I don't know if I'd want to see that. But
but you want to know a hospital that seems to have a problem.
Right,
you want to say, I'll stay for away from that one. Go to one that seems to know how to keep these things under control. So there are a lot of useful reforms. Another one, which hope the Republicans, despite their floundering, get to, is giving governors of states more discretion to reform Medicaid within their states. And I think you're going to see some very interesting things happen if they get that power, where you actually will save money and get better outcomes and make patients happier. For example, Rhode Island did a little bit of it a few years ago. One of the things they discovered is that instead of forcing patients to go into institutions, they did much better when they had home care. Well, home care was much cheaper than putting them in an institution, and the patient was happier.
Right.
So, win-win all around.
Yeah.
Give some flexibility. I think you'll see some real positive reforms.
Well, it's interesting. And then the second part was the tax code. And I'm curious, because you ran on you wanted a flat tax, right? I'm curious, do you think we'll ever see that? And why not?
We're not gonna get it this round.
Uh-huh.
But I hope this round we get some big cuts, perhaps on the business side, some cuts on the personal side. But I think the real cleanup of the code will come hopefully after next year's midterm elections. You know, when Reagan was president, he had a big cross-the-board tax cut in 1981, and then in the second term, they really did a clean out of the code of tax shelters,
mm-hmm.
and then they made some other reforms, simplified the code, got two tax brackets, cut the top rate down to 28%. And after cleaning the code, it passed the Senate 97-3. So I hope after the elections next year, there'll be a mandate. Hey, people like tax cuts. They want simplification. And what they're going to discover, the reason why I'm somewhat optimistic, is if you touch one deduction, you're going to have to hit all of them. Which is what the flat tax does. Just sweep them away.
Right. Well, it'll be interesting.
And by the way, if people are hung up on their pet deductions, even though my flat tax is designed in a way that everyone gets a tax cut, people just won't believe it. You do a variation of what Hong Kong does, and that is give people a choice. You can go with the new simplified system where you can just punch a few things on your computer or fill out a sheet of paper and you're done. Or if you want to torture yourself, you can stay with the old. See which one is better.
See
don't trust me. just see for yourself. I think that'll do it.
Well, and the last one was about the Fed. And I interviewed John Tamney about his book about he didn't think we needed the Fed. You're saying maybe reform and all that. I'm curious, do you think that we're going to see anything changes to the Fed? Will we go back to the gold standard? What do you think of that?
Well, maybe the Fed will disappear someday. But again, like healthcare, we have to do it step by step to make it happen. And that's why I think I hope the Trump administration uses this opportunity to start making reforms. One is to realize the need for a stable dollar, reduce the Fed's bloated portfolio. The Fed is thinking about it maybe at the end of the year. They should be forced to do it now, let that money go to work in the economy, and stop over-regulating banks. Jamie Dimon, the head of J.P. Morgan Chase, the other day said that because of regulations, between 1.5 trillion, underline the word trillion, 1.5 trillion to $2 trillion of loans were not made that otherwise would have been made. And most of those would have been for small and new businesses. Huge cost on the economy, these regs. And then ultimately, we have to make sure someday economists and pundits and politicians and business types recognize what money is. It's not in and of itself wealth. Money is a measure of value, like a scale is a measure of weight or a clock a measure of time. It's like a claim check. You know, you go to a restaurant, you park your coat, you get a claim check, coat check. It's a worthless piece of plastic or paper, but it represents a claim on a real thing. You buy a ticket to an event, whether it's on your handheld or a piece of paper, worthless in and of itself, but a claim on a real service. Mm-hmm. So money is like a claim check. And so therefore, trying to manipulate the value of the claim check just distorts the marketplace, just as if you continue to change weights and measures each day. You know, a pound is 14 ounces one day, 20 the next. Mm-hmm. Life would be chaotic. Imagine floating the clock. 60 minutes an hour one day, 80 minutes the next.
Right.
So if people grasp that, they can see just how utterly delusional and destructive this thing of trying to manipulate how you measure the value of things is. Keep it steady. Gold, for reasons we explain in the book, for 4,000 years, performed the job better than anything else.
Well, you really
And have... by the way, one final thing on that.
Mm-hmm.
Under the gold standard, which we had in this country for our first 180 years of existence, from the time of George Washington and Alexander Hamilton to the 1970s, during that time, for all the turmoil, wars, civil wars, world wars, depressions, through all of that, the average growth rate of about 3.5% in the U.S. was the highest in human history. Since we went off the gold standard, the average has plummeted. If we'd maintained that 180-year average after the 1970s, our economy today would be 50% larger.
Wow.
Imagine having 50% higher income. Life would be a lot better.
That's just amazing. It's so interesting.
Isn't it?
It's interesting. Everything you've written, I love to read your work because you're really an educator. I mean, you have your magazine, you have the website, you have interviews. And now you have the Forbes School of Business and Technology, which was a natural extension. And I'm thinking, you know so much about so many different things. And I have a lot of people that are leaders, who are leaders, I should say, that are listening to this, that maybe, I'm curious, like, as a leader and you're trying to hire people that are going to make your company go to the next level, what are you looking for in graduates and potential employees that you think, what do you think is the future of education, and for what should we look for in our potential hires?
Well, what you're trying to find is somebody who is disciplined, stick-to-itiveness, as maybe bring some particular skills to the table and the possibility of being able to develop or acquire other skills as well, somebody who can grow. And it also depends on what you're looking for at the time. It's like baseball. You may be looking for a pitcher one day and a utility infielder the next. Mm-hmm. So and this is where education, especially for profits, emerging from the attacks of the previous regime, can perform a very highly useful role, and that is providing specific skills and enabling doing at a fraction of the cost of some traditional universities and colleges. And one of the nice things about high tech is you can do education throughout your life. It's not one time and then that's it. So the future is wide open, and you're going to see a lot of entrepreneurship start to emerge. And ways of people go to school. Rich Karlgaard, our futurist guru, publisher at Forbes, once pointed out what he did. He did, I think, 2 years in a community college and then went on to Stanford University.
Right.
You can do 2 years of a community college and then go to a state school and save yourself a bundle of money. And why does it take 4 years to get a degree? You know, summertime, great. I love doing nothing. Or get in a job and getting paid. Uh-huh. And perhaps you take 5 weeks off and then go back to school and get it done in 2.5-3 years and be done with it. So a lot of changes are going to come. And one of the things young people should keep in mind is not everyone is going to win a Nobel Prize. Not everyone is going to, they like tennis, going to play at Wimbledon. Or be on the PGA Tour. And so what you want to do is you have a knack for something, great, develop it. But also in your quiver, have a few other skills that someday you might need. For example, Dilbert, you know, the comic strip,
mm-hmm.
Scott Adams.
Right.
He pointed out he was an okay illustrator, not great. Wasn't going to be put in the Metropolitan or be asked to do ceilings at the Vatican. Okay, illustrator.
Uh-huh.
Okay, writer. Decent, respectable, but not great. Okay, businessman. He'd been in, was in the corporate world for a number of years, which provided him considerable grist for his mill. So, but he took these skills, none of them world beaters, and put them together for an outstandingly successful comic strip, Dilbert. So it's like ingredients for a cake or a meal or something. The ingredients in and of themselves may not be much, but you put them together and it can be a wow experience.
Well, I agree. And I think you've got that gave some great advice there, because I think that there's so many leaders that are out there that just need to find the different ways to become educated in unique ways. And I'm very curious to see how that's going to change. And I think you've done so many things to keep up with innovation and technology, and you've written so many books, and I'm curious to see your next books. You keep churning out so many. I'm very curious to read the next ones. But for now, if somebody wants to read your current book, how can they find that?
They can find it online at Amazon or Barnes & Noble. Maybe the bookstores may have them, but it's just very easy. Click online, and they'll have it to you in a matter of hours. If the government ever gets out of the way, they could deliver it to you by a friendly drone. But we're not quite there yet.
Almost. Wow. But thank you so much, Steve. It was so nice of you to be on the show. I always enjoy meeting you and seeing at all of the events. And you've always been so gracious, and it's been very fun to get a little more insight from you.
Terrific. Good.
Well,
thank you. It was good fun to be with you, Diane. Thank you.
You're welcome. And we'll be back right after this message. Have you met with your financial planner recently to discuss avoiding negative consequences in your retirement? How to prolong taking Social Security benefits, create additional funding streams, and avoid taking funds out of your portfolio are questions that individuals 62 and older should consider. However, it's never too early to know your options. Once spent, retirement portfolio funds are gone. However, a reverse mortgage will utilize some of the equity you've built up over time and still allow you to enjoy the benefit of living in and enjoying your home, as well as the ability to leave remaining equity to your heirs. It's time to explore this powerful tool and see why many of the greatest retirement researchers have embraced reverse mortgages. An elite certified reverse mortgage professional can help you explore the benefits of reverse mortgages. There's only 143 of them in the country. Find out how Nina Penny, who has this distinguished certification, can help you with your reverse mortgage and planning needs. You can reach her at nina@simplereversemortgage.net or call her at 480-635-2410, NMLS 168272, Arizona Wholesale Mortgage Incorporated 19254. Are you looking for some advice and resources to help you start your own business? Enlist the Startup Professionals team. Their advice and resources can help you achieve your dreams. Every one of their team members has been there and done that. Here are some of the benefits to you. Reduced overall cost and overhead for company startup. Improved relationships with investors. Intellectual property protected. Competitive advantage maximized. Attract top caliber executives and employees. Startup founders have time to focus on product development and recruiting. An entrepreneur must focus on finding solutions for real problems rather than finding real problems to fit their solution. To reach Marty and his team at Startup Professionals, call 480-789-1621. Check out their website at startupprofessionals.com or email him personally at marty@startupprofessionals.com. Well, I really want to thank Steve for being my guest. It's so nice of you, Steve. Thank you so much. You're always so fascinating, and I look forward to seeing you at all the events. I don't know if any of you go to any of these Forbes summits, but they are just amazing. I have attended several, from the CMO summits to the Midwestern, they've had reinventing the Midwest type of summits. They've and the Women's Summit, and they're very hard to get into, to be honest with you. But if you can ever get to go to one of these things, they are amazing. He's also got the cruises he does, where they invite people like Rich Karlgaard, Mark Mills, who's been on my show, and a lot of others. They go on these cruises and have these top speakers share content and information. So I really love everything that I've been associated with at Forbes. I ran the MBA program at the Forbes School of Business, and I have worked with the school since 2006, prior to even being associated with Forbes. But what really led to making this show so interesting was a lot of the people I had met through my association with Steve and the people at Forbes. We get a lot of Forbes 30 under 30s on the show, and they're just so innovative. If you hadn't had a chance to go to the website, my website, and if you go to drdianehamilton.com/episodes, you can see a lot of the guests that we've had in the past, and many of them are Forbes related in some aspect. And they're just these 30 under 30 guests have created apps. We've done other things that have made them stand out at such an amazing age. People like Ty Tran, Brian Wong, just Anne Dugonska. I mean, you look at the list of some of these people of what they've done. It's just amazing. So I'm just taking this time because it's really kind of hard to figure out who you're going to line up with Steve Forbes, because people would be lining up to all want to be on the same show with Steve. So I decided to give Steve this entire show and take the rest of it just to talk to you a little bit, because I normally don't like to talk into the microphone when I'm not talking to somebody else, because it's the hardest part of what I do, actually. But I also want to give you a little bit of background about this show and what we're trying to do with just what we do here. And it's a show dedicated to success and leadership. And I have so many CEOs and C-level executives, just very successful individuals who I like to interview, just to kind of share what they're doing. But it's kind of challenging sometimes because it gets so busy that I'm actually booking like 4 or 5 months ahead sometimes, and I have to not be able to interview everybody I'd like to interview. But well, the good news is that we've got great listenership, and we're on so many stations, in addition to being on the AM FM stations that we're syndicated on. We're also on Roku, iHeart, iTunes, I mean, you name it. So we're always looking for good sponsors we can have associated with the show, affiliate marketers and that type of thing. So I think it's really helpful to just see what we're doing by going to iTunes and checking out the podcast. You can download them, or you can go to my site, of course, at drdianehamilton.com. And other things that are associated with my site, just so that you know what else I do. In addition to this show, and in addition to teaching for 7 online universities, and I actually do a few things. I have taught over more than, I should say, 1,000 business-related courses. I've taught everything from undergrad, grad, and doctorate level students, and I've worked as a doctoral mentor to get students through their dissertation. So I use a lot of the information that I've learned through my teaching and through this show. We share a lot of information, and some of that can be really helpful when I teach, because I can, you know, depending on the show, I can use a lot of that content within the classrooms. And I have a lot of courses I teach in marketing, for example, and we get a lot of social media experts or branding experts, and that is something that I would maybe direct them to this show. So I could see that there's a lot of potential for companies that want to associate with us. And if you do have an interest in being a sponsor or being an affiliate with the show, I would welcome the opportunity to talk to you about that. I know we only have so much room, but it's such an amazing platform to reach people. And I think that we're going to start seeing a lot more people doing what I'm doing here, which is, you know, you have your way of having your own broadcasting system. And, you know, whether it's this or through my videos or through whatever, we're able to reach people, and people can sign up to receive the shows when they come out and be notified. And I think it's kind of taking the place of what we used to do in terms of television and radio and just having such limited options. But as far as having a Steve on the show, you know, it's just amazing to me to see what you can learn from each guest. And every time I interview somebody, I learn something new. And every time I teach a course, I learn something new. And I think a lot of the things that we're talking about on these shows, our leaders really need to embrace, because I know I do a lot of consulting, and in my consulting and speaking, usually the top requested things that people want me to come talk to them about are soft skills, engagement, culture, generational conflict, and those are the kinds of things that you're going to hear a lot on this show. So I think it's really important to just showcase what we do here. And this, after recording hundreds of episodes, I finally decided to take this one to do that. And I think that it's a good opportunity for anyone interested in knowing what we do here to find out more. And just for those of you who are interested, I am available through LinkedIn and my website and Twitter, and everything is all at Dr. Diane Hamilton. Either drdianehamilton.com, and that's drdianehamilton as one word without any spaces, or on Twitter. And I accept all invitations on LinkedIn, but just wanted you to know just a little bit more about the show and what we do. And I hope that all of you would, if you're using iTunes, please rate the show, because I think we could use, you know, always love to hear great testimonials, and hope that you guys sign up and continue to listen. And we will be back right after this message.
Attend any corporate summit, and it's likely someone will bring up issues with millennials or other generational conflict. In the book, It's Not You, It's Your Personality, the authors explore the post-boomer generations and how to use personality assessments to get along in the modern workplace. Learn what makes the younger workforce unique. filled with tips, tricks, and techniques. It's not you, it's your personality. Outlines various scenarios with different personalities to give you a more detailed look at how different people can more effectively work together, both in team situations and when various activities require them to better understand one another. You'll learn how to recognize character traits in others, as well as in yourself, and what to do about the traits that need help. Entertaining as well as educational, it's not you, it's your personality, makes understanding personality assessment essential to workplace success. To get your copy, text the word Diane, D-I-A-N-E, to 38470. That's Diane, D-I-A-N-E, at 38470.
Robots, self-driving transportation, and a dynamically connected cross-cultural virtual world will define the workplace of tomorrow. However, education today is mainly focused on technical learning and standardized testing. Is this preparing kids for future leadership? Unfortunately, not so much. That's why LeaderKid Academy offers programs based on the persona model and focuses on developing emotional intelligence, project management, change management, mindfulness, assertiveness, ethical leadership, resilience, creativity and innovation, and presentation skills. LeaderKid Academy offers educator mentoring and training workshops, after-school programs, and ongoing sessions. Unleash the leader in your kid. To learn more, visit leaderkid.org. That's LeaderKid.org. Well, as we run out of time here, one last thing I'd like to mention is the videography type of things that we offer now. I don't know how many of you have seen my YouTube station, but if you haven't, I've interviewed some really successful individuals. Ken Fisher, the billionaire behind Fisher Investments, Olin Odekoven, who's the CEO of very successful Peregrine, John Tamney, who we talked about on the show today, who is a big writer for Forbes and an author, and a lot of very successful individuals have been part of my video interviewing. And one of the services I'm starting to offer is for companies that who want to showcase an individual or want a video for their site to showcase what they do or their products or whatever they're interested in. I'm starting to do more of that with companies. So if you're interested in creating a video that can be placed, YouTube, different locations and that type of thing, please get a hold of me and we can see if we offer something that could be beneficial to you. And of course, videos are always showcased on my sites, so YouTube, Twitter, LinkedIn, and that type of thing. But basically, those are the types of services we offer, and we have some great guests. It's one of the hardest things that I have to do in this show is to wait to air shows, because usually I interview somebody and then it takes from 4 to 6 weeks usually before it airs, and it just is so hard when you have such a great interview and you want to release it and you have to wait for that time. But I do work with guests who have books that are coming out, you know, and they need something released maybe at a certain time. So if you have something special and you are working with me as a guest, please let me know when that release is, and we can see what we can do to speed things up if that's the case. But basically, that's the focus of the show. We really want to get people out there that are successful leaders to share their success with people, and so people can learn to emulate what they've done. And we've had some of the most unbelievable guests, and I hope to continue to have interviews with some more amazing guests. And there's just a bottomless well. I mean, it just continues to amaze me of how many people I couldn't find to interview that have something new and different to share with everybody. So if you have any input that you'd like to share, something you would like to hear about on the show, something we haven't covered or anything, any questions, please contact me. You can always email me. You can even use my personal email. That's drdianehamilton@gmail.com. And you could find all of my contact information again at drdianehamilton.com. And that'll do it for today's show. Thank you again, Steve Forbes. You were awesome. I thoroughly enjoyed it. And I hope everybody checks out his books and website. And everybody come back for the next episode of Take the Lead Radio.